Here's a summary table showing all four of the integer data types, their byte sizes, and their exact minimum and maximum values. Don't worry, it's not necessary to commit these values to memory. If you can remember that an int data type is about plus or minus 2.1 billion, and a short data type is about plus or minus 32,000, that's plenty sufficient for our purposes. In our programs, we'll typically use integer data types for whole-valued numbers not requiring any decimal precision. For example, things such as counts, quantities, populations, ages, IDs, and so forth would be represented using an int or a long data type. In this course, we won't make much use of the byte or short data types. My understanding is that these two data types were mainly provided for back compatibility with the C-like programming languages to encourage migration to Java. But you can imagine some context in which they would be useful, such as for very large arrays or matrices where storage space might be at a premium. Here on the right, you can see some example declarations, and I think from the variable names, it should be pretty apparent what kind of data this is. Again, by the intrinsic nature of all these data quantities being whole numbered values, they would naturally be declared with some int data types. For example, a dice roll or a population doesn't require decimal accuracy, nor does an age, once you're above 4 or 5 years old, I suppose. Here's another summary table showing both of the floating point data types, their byte sizes, and their approximate minimum and maximum values and resolutions. As you can see, both of these data types can handle huge numbers with extreme precision. In our programs, we'll use floating point data types for any numerical values requiring either decimal precision or exponents, or both. Anything requiring a decimal point should be declared as either a float or a double. Some typical examples of these would be such things as costs or prices, averages, precise calculations, and so on. So again, here on the right, you can see some example declarations of program quantities requiring either of the floating point data types in Java, a float or a double. The char data type, again, is used to represent 16-bit Unicode character values. As we'll see a bit later, it turns out that we can represent these characters as either a single character within single quotes or as a hex or decimal number. Some things we might use char data types for would be such things as letter grades, user options, or perhaps user inputs from a keyboard. Again, on the right are some examples for each of those data needs. Finally, the Boolean data type is used to store the indicated two specific values only, true or false. Its exact size internally is unspecified, as it's JVM specific. We would use variables of the Boolean data type in any situation where we have binary, two-valued states, or later, as we'll see, for determining the outcome of decision-making in Java's various logical constructs. Here on the left are some examples of various data quantities which would require a Boolean data type, and on the right are some corresponding variable names for such Boolean values. Again, Boolean variables can store only two possible values, true or false, and nothing else. It's worth noting that while we have only 8 primitive data types in Java, the class names that we use in Java also serve in effect as additional data types. Classes will be one of two kinds: classes provided by Java as extensions to the core language, and classes that we create ourselves. When we instantiate or create a new object from a class that we've written, we're creating a new object that, practically speaking, has a user-defined data type. But we're also telling the compiler here how much space it needs to set aside in memory to hold one of those new objects. For example, in this code example, when we created a person object from the hello class, it's really an object of the user-defined hello data type, as we've underlined here in red. So objects in Java also have data types. Their data types are of the class from which they were created or instantiated. Finally, there's a class in Java that we'll be using frequently to create text data, and that's the string class. We can put any number of characters inside double quotes as shown here, and it will be considered an object of type string. If you recall, you created several strings like this as part of your first two Hello World lab assignments. We do this so often in programming that it's tempting to view string as a ninth primitive data type in Java, but it's really not. String is a Java class and not one of its primitive data types. Again, we should realize that Java classes, whether part of the language like string here, or new ones that we create, can be thought of as additional special purpose data types. To wrap up with a larger perspective, here's my first stab at comparing data types across programming languages. As suggested by these question marks, I can't vouch 100% for all the details of this information, but I'm confident it's a reasonably accurate starting point. I'll probably be revising this as the semesters progress. You'll often hear me say it this semester. If this is your first programming language, learn the concepts well once in Java, and then the next languages you learn will start to look very familiar. Here's some more evidence of that. Notice that we have Java here on the far left side and various other common languages in the adjacent columns. Note that all the languages have very similar or identical data types. C and C++ in particular are very closely similar. HTML is kind of the oddball here. It has no data types, as it's purely a markup language and does not retain data in variables. That's why JavaScript is often paired with HTML. Once again, while the details may differ, and you can always look those up, the concept of data types to store different types of information is universal across programming languages. Okay, now that we understand Java's eight primitive data types, we'll next look at how to go about creating variables from those eight data types.